Thank you so much. It is my pleasure to be given this opportunity to share with you the reconciliation and peace work done by Shalom, Educating for Peace, as well as the lessons learned from our field experience in Rwanda, and to get the opportunity to share with you my thoughts on the responsibility to reconcile violent conflicts. In addition, I would like to use this opportunity to request your support to our reconciliation and peace education work. As this month I am in this speaking tour to mobilize friends and funds. dear participants, I come from Rwanda, a country with a historical background marked by multifaceted violent conflicts, wars, and genocide, 1994 genocide. To rebuild the post-genocide country, it has required efforts of every Rwandan and support from our friends. Working for unity and reconciliation has been one of the cornerstones that the development of the post-genocide Rwanda should rely on. In 2007, my friend Corey, this lady from South Africa, and I decided to establish a structure that could enable us to contribute to the process of reconciliation and peace building process in Rwanda and the Great Lakes region. We met in South Africa. I was doing a master's program in peace building program under the supervision of Jeff Harris. This man is a kind man. I recognized him as my mentor. He came from Australia with commitment to equip Africans with capacities to transform conflicts non-violently. And in South Africa, he established a peace building program at the University of KwaZulu-Natal. And now he's based at Durban University of Technology. Corey and I, we are the former students of Jeff Harris. The co-founders of Shalom believe in education as a powerful tool to transform people's mindset. As you know, all conflicts begin in our minds. And to transform conflict, we have to correct something in our minds. So this is not done by using guns or by using force, just by education. As Mandela said, education is a powerful tool to transform the whole society. We created the organization Shalom Educating for Peace with the mission of building and sustaining positive peace through education. The organization has three strategic objectives, which are educating communities for peace, researching for peace, and cultivating the culture of non-violence. But why the name of Shalom? Wherever I travel, I have been asked, why did we name this organization Shalom? Do we have any link with Jewish people? My response is no, we don't have any link. But this word, this concept of Shalom has attracted our attention. This word has an extraordinary meaning in our understanding and has five components which make the framework of Shalom's peace-building work. With Shalom, to name it Shalom, the founders wanted to express their willingness and their vision of moving communities toward holistic and positive peace through building the five pillars or components of Shalom, which are, with Shalom we want to see enemies reconciled, to see injustice righted, to see hearts healed, to see fear calmed, and to see community prospering. Those five components that makes the frameworks of Shalom, those five components makes Shalom, which means peace in its fullness. At Shalom Educating for Peace, we have as beneficiaries, communities, community as a whole. We try to have a comprehensive or a holistic approach involving the all members of community. Community is our target. In Africa, we used to use this word target, but in other parts of Africa, they used to say, no, you should change this word. Target is so military. When you say target, it's a military terminology. Because you know you target someone. We work with and alongside the community as a whole, but we keep our gross eye on children. Agreeing with Gandhi, who said that if we want peace, we have to begin with children, it is worth the effort to note that children are not totally passive subjects in our communities. They can appear as change agents. They are potentially change bringers in their societies. In young countries like Rwanda, where children represent 48% of the total population, it is necessary to engage children if you have to successfully move toward positive peace. And this is one of the specificities of this small organization, Shalom Educating for Peace. We engage children in the process. Since its creation, Shalom has piloted and implemented a number of projects, which are Ubupfura project. In our work, we realize that corruption undermine the whole peace building process. So we initiated an anti-corruption education using a cultural concept which such as Ubupfura. Ubupfura is a Kinyarwanda word. That means there is no other equivalent words in other languages. But when you bring together values such as integrity, transparency, nobility, truth speaking, those values brought together form Ubupfura. So with this Ubupfura project, we want to build an understanding that resists corruption. Because corruption, we realize, that is an issue that undermines the peace-building process. And we involve children, too, in this process, in this anti-corruption education. This is my dearest project, because since 2011 up to 2015, March, I have been doing my doctoral research focusing on this project, anti-corruption education as a way of building positive peace in Rwanda. And what I can say is that with some more commitment to work for peace through this this concept, last June, I was presented at the Rwandan Senate. I was asked to present about this Ubupfura, because we didn't need to develop or to promote. Rwanda is a country that is trying to build a corruption-free nation, which is so difficult. I was asked to come and present this project, Ubupfura project, And it was in a consultative meeting on anti-corruption strategies in Rwanda. And as the among the 11 resolutions that came up in this meeting, the promoting Wupfura values was the first resolution. And I'm confident and I'm happy of this outcome. Other projects include resolving and transforming conflict within cooperatives. I don't know if you have the same concept of cooperatives here. When people come together, form groups for economic purposes. So we use this economic groupings framework to introduce conflict transformation knowledge and skills in order to help the cooperative to do not collapse. Because many cooperatives, people come together, work in cooperatives, and at the end of the day, you find them collapse because of lacking skills for conflict transformation. Another project which is very recent is Living and Learning Without Fear project. With this project, we want to address gender-based violence and ending corporal and alienating punishment in homes and schools. Different reports on corporal punishment in Rwanda say that between 49 and 51% of children in schools have been victim or have seen teacher beating their colleague or beating themselves. Yeah. So beating the children. So we also want to address this issue. And another project we have is building capacities of community levels forums for reconciliation project. I wanted to present this at the end because this is the focus of my presentation. How Shalom reach and impact a wide audience? We reach wide audience through radio shows. We have a weekly interactive radio show where we present peace education knowledge, and people can call in and ask questions. You know, radio is very important in Africa. Even someone who is in his garden, he holds a radio nearby, following the. So radio was used. I remember, we know radio was used for constructive or destructive purposes in our continent, in Africa. And when I look at the context of genocide in Rwanda, radio was used to manipulate people and motivate them to kill their fellow Rwandans. We also use workshops, artistic methods such as songs and theaters. I remember one in 2009, we organized a concert with one church choir trained in the reconciliation process. And we had more than 1,000 people attending the event. It is a way to reach many people. We use also sports. Shalom has developed the materials such as peace education through sports approaches. We use different international days such as Peace Day, International Day of Peace, Anti-Corruption Day, Mother's Day to educate for peace. Now let's have a focus on reconciliation process. Dear participants, Shalom considers promoting reconciliation and social cohesion as key element of building positive peace, not only in Rwanda and the Great Lakes region, but also in Africa and the rest of the world. Even here, I know you have a commission on that, and you need to continue, even though the commission closed. Yeah. It was closed yesterday, but you still have to go on in this process. The historical background of humankind, regardless of our different race, ethnics, religion, regions of origin, etc., we believe that we as human beings need reconciliation. We need restoring not only our relationships, but also our interconnectedness. For Shalom, reconciliation is the framework for healing and recovery, truth-telling, forgiveness and repair of harm done, restoring relationships, calming fear, trust building, reconsidering the interconnectedness of human beings, and commitment to righting injustice and addressing the consequences of historical wrongs as a way of breaking the circle of violence. We are convinced that a successful and sustainable reconciliation process requires freedom, empathy, equality, and inclusiveness. Those are sine qua non conditions for a successful and sustainable reconciliation. To be sustainable, the reconciliation process should be free. Freedom. Freedom to speak. To speak your mind, your emotions. To be sustainable, the reconciliation process should be inclusive. No one should be left behind, and everyone's voice should be heard. Everyone's voice should be considered, respected, regardless his capacity, his status or her status. Everyone should be included in the process. And the reconciliation process requires equality. People should work at equal basis. And the reconciliation process requires empathy. We need to listen to one another, to put ourselves in one's shoes, if you say that in English, I don't know. Some of the obstacles and the challenges to the process of reconciliation in Rwanda, I think some of are applicable to your context too. Those challenges are looked at individual and community level. Because really, Rwanda has made remarkable progress at political level, reconciliation at political level. I really admire where we are with this process. But at individual and community level, we still have many challenges, which include divergences on Rwandan history. It is bizarre, it is understandable to find even teachers who are cautious and don't want to teach the history, Rwandan history subject in our schools because people have different version of history. There is a lack of effective and practical community-level dialogue infrastructures for reconciliation. There is a persistence of genocide and divisionist ideologies among some people. Those were collected from the beneficiaries of our programs in Rwanda. Many offenders didn't truly beg pardon. Some say just, we are sorry, we recognize what we did because of other pressures, but not truly from their heart, not really genuinely. There is a mistrust and the lack of truth telling. Some people prefer to keep silent, avoid to talk about this process and what happened and so on. And some have fear. And there are suspicions between people. We remarked also misconception of what reconciliation is. In our work as education organization, Shalom, as a peace education organization, we try to help people understand that reconciliation doesn't mean cohabitation. Because Rwandans has been lived together in the same village, sharing whatever the community members can share. Before the genocide, it was like that. And even after the genocide, the same. Cohabitation doesn't mean reconciliation. And also another challenge is about corruption. Corruption is undermining, is undermining factor of the process. Dear participants, let me share with you some of lessons learned through our work. Maybe some of them can be applicable to the process of reconciliation and social cohesion in your beautiful country, Canada. Through our work, we realized that using local resources such as storytelling, theaters, and songs reflecting the realities of people's life has a greater impact than using materials presenting the realities from far away. So as we are engaged in this process, we need to look at the realities, the cultural values, the realities that are happening, and local resources to help us moving toward the sustainable reconciliation. Educating people, another lesson we learned is that educating people through existing structures and usual practices like church activities, concert, entertainment, would be easier way to reach people and could have a remarkable impact on their daily life. With little means, this is another lesson we learned, because at Shalom, we have been challenged since our creation up to date. We have been challenged by lack of means, financial means. But at least you have a commitment to do this work. With little means, committed peace builders can perform a great job and transform a human society. A small community level reconciliation initiative can play a catalytic role and influence national decision makers. We have to work, another lesson we learned is that we have to work with different actors in society and mobilize policies and decision makers to allocate resources to community level reconciliation initiatives. Sometimes they don't understand reconciliation as a priority. We have been mobilizing government people in Rwanda to understand that this is and should be one of the national priorities. They used to say, yes, yeah, you are correct, you are true, this is a priority, but how do we assess that everyone understands that it's priority? Recently, I was talking to a group of parliamentarians, saying that we will recognize that, we will know that you know that it is a priority. If you look at how much money you allocate to this process. Another lesson we learned is that the government can contribute to the process through creating conducive environment for reconciliation and financially. But the process of reconciliation remains mainly the affairs of people living together in their communities, and particularly between victims and offenders. I read the 94 recommendation from your Truth and Reconciliation Commission. I saw everywhere they say government should do that. And something I want to tell you important tonight is that the government can contribute to one way or another, but the reconciliation remains the affairs of people, especially between victim and offenders. Another important lesson we learned is that reconciliation without truth, without healing the wound of the past, and without forgiveness doesn't exist. Here, I'm sorry, I'm categorical on this. Reconciliation without truth, reconciliation without healing the wound of the past and reconciliation without forgiveness doesn't exist. Another lesson I mentioned that is that genuine and sustainable reconciliation doesn't mean cohabitation. Also, reconciliation works for under the responsibility of the human society, including offenders, victims, and other members of the human society. Reconciliation is our responsibility. In a situation where relationships are damaged, our interconnectedness as human beings calls us to look or work for a reconciled society, even though it has been something very difficult to engage in. The human interconnectedness presses us to seek for reconciliation and work for preventing the reoccurrence of the violence. Additionally, the responsibility to reconcile violence goes beyond different human-created boundaries. Everyone aware of the destructive effects of living in a divided society on today's and tomorrow's generations should make efforts for reconciliation in order to ensure harmonic lives. As the history of humankind has recorded lamentable atrocities, human trafficking, massacres, wars, genocide, and other regrettable violence and historical wrongs such as slavery, domination, occupation, colonization, apartheid, and so on, it is our responsibility to join efforts and work for a reconciled world. Let me here remind you that each violent conflict creates responsibility to respond to many challenges created by the harm committed. We have, in each violent conflict, we have responsibility to preserve the dignity of both perpetrators and victims as reconcilable creation. In a context of conflict, violent conflict, you have the responsibility to create space for wrongs and sufferings to be named and acknowledged. We have the responsibility to have perpetrators getting a safe environment that enable them to express sorrow and genuinely ask for pardon for their harmful deed. We have the responsibility to take care for victims and help them to heal their wounds. We have the responsibility to take care for perpetrators, to calm their fear and guilt, to help them rediscover their humanness and heal emotional wounds caused by the harms. We have the responsibility to repair what is repairable, and we have the responsibility to create and support conducive environment for the reconciliation to happen. Taking responsibility to reconcile violent conflict requires people's commitment to restoring relationships and sustaining social cohesion. From our work, we learned that this commitment comes from three key elements: love, truth, telling, and the readiness to making sacrifice. Love helps us to open our hearts and empathically feel sufferings caused by the hurt. With love, truth inevitably emerges. Love never hides or betrays truth. It makes people becoming brave and courageous, acting for reconciliation. But our everyday experience shows us that we live in a world where truth-speaking people encounter fellow human beings who always want to silence them. As reconciliation requires truth-telling, taking our responsibility as reconciliation actors necessitates being prepared to make sacrifice. Indeed, loving people makes us ready to speak truth despite the sacrifice it requires. Dear friend, this is what we have done and we have learned from this peace building, reconciliation, and reconciliation process. To be able to continue this work, I would like to take this opportunity of this speaking tour to request your support. We would welcome any form of support. It may be one of donations, continuation donation at regular basis, voluntary services in one of Shalom's projects, or fundraising efforts, or connecting us with potential supporting organization. Before I end my speech, I would like to express my gratitude to Teresa Dan and acknowledge the support of Canadian Peace Initiative, as well as the support by Science for Peace for the invaluable contribution to the organization of this speaking tour in Canada. Thank you all for your consideration and for your kind attention. Please let us join our efforts to move our communities and the world toward sustainable reconciliation and durable peace. Working for a reconciled and peaceful human society is everyone's effort and responsibility. Thank you for your kind attention. May peace prevail in Canada. May peace prevail in Rwanda. May peace prevail in the rest of the world.